So here we'll discuss about anti-spam. So controlling spam with Cisco sensor-based and anti-spam features. So here, I hope I have saved this. Okay. So anti-spam, you know, processes scan email for incoming and outgoing. Maybe like as we see that incoming mail policy, we can implement anti-spam on incoming mail policy, even outgoing email policy, and also I just said there is a scanning engines like Sophos and antivirus scanning, just like there Sophos and McAfee. The similar way, there is a web root. There's anti-spam features integrated with the email security appliance. So scanning engines which will assign the scores for each messages and based on the case context adaptive security engines. Initially I just explained that like there is a 1 to 100 range scores, and they define positive spam, suspected spam, or clean messages. So based on that, the message verdict will be provided, and as per the policy, incoming and outgoing mail policy, message will be treated if it is a spam or not. So here, best practice for managing spam messages, the aggressive approach provides better performance, like drop positive spam. So once email security appliance engines like found that mail is spam, then aggressive approach we can drop, or we can quarantine suspected spam if it is suspected. Other conservative or traditional approach like default settings provide better false positive discovery, like quarantine positive spam or even suspected spam. So both is quarantine. And how to do that settings? You have to go under the security settings, security services, and Iron Port anti-spam global setting, where we can define this message scanning thresholds, and you can define the message size and time for timeout for scanning single messages, like how much seconds, like you can define here. So as I said last time, maybe let me show you there. We discuss about, case contact, yeah, this one, I think, yeah, I want it. So based on this criteria, like we have to just define whether a message is anti-spam. So like here, who is sending email messages, what content is included, how message was constructed, and where does the message go? I mean, what is the reputation of the website or the domain which is sending email messages? So we can get all those informations. And this is the score rating, and from where we can define if it is positive, greater than 90 score case is finding, then it is most probably, you know, spam messages. If it is greater than 50, then suspected one, and less than that, or equal to 49, that is a clean messages. Now, quarantining and the spam on the Cisco email security appliance. And here is the some parameters we can define. The following are the default setting for the local spam quarantine parameters and default settings. And spam quarantine enabled, that is called Iron Port spam quarantine, in short ISQ. Quarantine size 2.5 gig, and scheduled delete after 14 days. So after 14 days, that will delete quarantine messages. And end user quarantine access is enabled, so end user can access the quarantine by the link provided. End user authentication default none. A spam notification message by default off. These are the default settings. We can tune it. So here, configuring end user authentication, if you want, so you can see here is quarantine name, is spam quarantine, and message, the number of messages you find here, you and retain 14 days, then delete it. and options you can find under the monitor sections, mail policies. And here you can see spam quarantine. Describing safe list and block list. So what is the safe list and block list? Any idea?
Presumably that's similar to the groups that we spoke earlier, which emails should be blocked, which emails should be saved.
Yeah. So there we can define safe list and block list, just like you said. Here we can say white list and black list. So the similar way, there is a controlling spam with the Cisco sensor base, and we know that sensor base just defines the reputations of the domain or IP address, or even they're just messages, and then they are working on that and by defining the score for that particular domain. So safe list, block list, per user basis, we can implement that safe list and block list. So safe list will do what? It will define trusted email address and domain and subdomains, and bypass spam scanning, and it will scan the viruses and content filters. Plus block list, you can say it will allow end user to define spam sources, like from which spam sources, if the mail is coming, then it should be blocklisted. And administrator determines if the blocklist mail or quarantine or deleted. So end users log in to spam quarantine and notified by the admin mail, and they can release and add to the safe list from the drop down list available. So safe list, block list database, you can find in a comma separated value format other than the XML format. And here, so safe list have these features and block list have the following features. So safe list enable the end user to define trusted address, subdomains and domains. Messages from safe list entries are designed as a safe and bypass spam scanning completely. And that means simply we can say white, similar to whitelist, and messages are still scanned for virus and content filters to check if there is any filter you have implemented for incoming mail policy or outgoing mail policy. Block list have the following features. Block list let end users define spam sources, and message from sender address or domain that are designated as a spam or explicitly marked as a spam. So administrator determine if the blocklist email or quarantine are deleted. So the administrator must backup separately of the blocklist database. Configuring safe list and blocklist, here we can go into that location, monitor spam quarantine, and define enable end user safe list blocklist, and what action you want to define for the blocked one. Blocked action, quarantine. Maximum list item per users, you can define 100. Safe list and block list deployment. So admin policy trump user policies. Admin policy in message filter, that's the CLI completely, occurs before safe list and block list in the walk queue. More specific policy trump less specific policy. So an example of policy hierarchy would be like email address or subdomain. For example, a user sets up the following, like safe list friend at annoyingvendor.com and block list is annoyingvendor.com. Then what happened? The user receives mail from the friend, okay, but all other mail from the domain is blocked. So because safe list is as per the email address. So message splinter is an options with the multiple recipient will be splintered if some of the recipient have a safe list or block list the sender. Now the question is that what is message splinter? So actually what happened, as I said, the incoming mail policy and outgoing mail policy, suppose a mail is coming from the outside. So and the mail is delivered to two different domain, like suppose there is a mail coming from the outside message ID 1 and email. User 1 at outside.com and going to Alan at notes.alpha.com and plus it is also going to Joe at exchange.So actually there's two recipient, one is Alan and one is Joe. And what happened, we have two different set of policy. One, we can define here incoming policies to drop, okay, or and here to just we can say to perform anti spam. Just for example, to disable anti spam. I mean anti spam, not checking anti spam here. So these are the two policy. So you see there's two different set of policy and on the same message ID one, or I mean single message in this one, but two different kind of policies implemented on this message ID. So what happened? This is called splintering. Two different set of policies on the same message. So it will be treated differently. So that's what that is called message splintering. Right, sir?
Yes, based on the domain.
Now use headers to track and test spam messages. So there's just some examples and status headers, like just to test whether the message is spam or just to assign message as a spam. So status header x-ironport anti-spam filter true, troubleshoot confirm the message was scanned by the anti-spam, plus spam headers we can add for the advertisements like related spam and suspect or marketing. These are the three tags we can associate. Define spam body. There is some script here. And testing insert in body to trigger spam positive verdict. So these are the headers. By using this tuning, we can just test used to trigger a spam positive verdict or suspect or marketing email verdict by adding this information. Bounce verification. So bounce verification is what actually bounce verification tag is happen in case of DOS attack. Now, what happened in DOS attack, someone sending packet on behalf of someone or non-existent domain, non-existent IP, and when the receiving device will get packets and then try to respond to the legitimate servers, but that server is maybe off, maybe that server is not active, and but that guy is still busy. So to stop that, there is a bounce verification. So the same thing happened in email security appliance. So someone sending on behalf of someone email message, and the server receiving device will try to respond. So that may be case. So here, so here is the attackers, and he is performing a kind of DOS attack on behalf of maybe there is a servers or there is a domain, and on behalf of users and sending email message to this section servers. This is, we can say, and this attacker sending from Allen at .com user 1, maybe user 100 at outside .com, which is non-existent. Maybe user is not available there. So when the message is going here, so when the mail is going from here, this guys will do what? It will say, it will respond with that recipient not found. So that recipient user 1, user 100 at outside.com doesn't exist, and that's what this guys will respond to this to Exchange servers. So that to Allen respond bounce message. To Allen at simply we can say at exchange.alpha.com. So maybe there is a hundreds of masses or millions of masses, you know, attacker initiating, and that, you know, all that masses, you know, is coming to hear this. So this way, what happened, there may be flood of UC masses, unsolicited masses or bounce masses, we can say. So many masses is coming. So how we can protect this? So bounce verification tag is required here. So what happened? This guy is sending 100 email on behalf of this, you know, Alan@exchange.alpha.com, and the user 100 is not existing here, and 100 message and bounce back message coming back here, maybe more than that. So this ESA gonna be easy to process that unnecessarily. So what happened? We can perform the bounce verification tag. How? So in this case, once we define the bounce verification tag here, so whatever mails leaving the organizations, like the legitimate mail. So if any legitimate mail going from finance to outside, maybe I'm saying outside, or we can say if it is going from this one, maybe we can say if it is going from notes.alpha.com. So all they will be, you know, marked with the notification, tag, that is called VVT, bounce verification tag. Bounce verification. So what happened? A kind of numbers will be generated here. So suppose Alan@notes.alpha.com sending any message to user1@outside.com. Then what happened? Here, BVT bounce verification tag will be added. For example, this ESA will have this number, something. And so when mail is coming back, then email security appliance will look for this, you know, tag, bounce verification tag. If that tag is matching, then the bounce message will be accepted. If it is not, then it will discard. So this way, it will stop unnecessary flooding of messages from the outside. Sir, I hope you got it, right?
Yes.
Okay. So bounce verification gives protections against flooding with bounced email errors. So here you can see DOS attackers from Joe here sending on behalf of this. And if it is bounce verification, then what happened? Whatever mail leaving from this ESA will add the value 123 and something value at mydomain.com. So once the mail is coming back, response, then it will check for that. Bounce or verified by tags and or delivered, untagged bounces are dropped. So this is the main reason to stop the DOS attack by using the bounce verification. How you will do that? So you will go to the mail policy sections, and within that you'll find bounce verification. And here, bounce verification settings. Action when invalid bounce received, rejected, and new keys will be added here if you want. So this is bounce verification tagging keys. You can add it here. This is the action, and here is the keys to add. Now, antivirus, and here Antivirus, like, you know, this is for incoming and outgoing. Both places we can set this antivirus scanning. So you can see here, this is incoming mail policy reputation filter is enabled, message filter, anti-spam, antivirus here. So antivirus can be enabled in both direction, inbound and outbound. So just give me 1 second.
Sure.
Yes, sir. So here, antivirus overview. Cisco supports multiple antivirus engines. And as I said, the Sophos and McAfee. Choose to enable Sophos or McAfee antivirus engines or both to scan for viruses in the work queue. Sophos and McAfee antivirus provides a virus detection engines that scans for viruses and Trojan horse and worms. Now, recommended antivirus practice, like the following or antivirus best practice: drop virus messages if it is infected, and drop messages that cannot be repaired, like unscannable messages. Maybe we can say are unrepairable. So we can drop, be aware of any regulatory issues. And if archived, modify subject to alert. So if it is encrypted message, then you can also say that to drop messages. Do not do the following, like archive viruses and send notification to everyone. This action create a spam and redirect infected message to another mailbox. So these are the things that is that to be restricted. And by default, unscannable and encrypted files are delivered with a warning in the subject header that this message is encrypted and maybe virus worms and virus. So this way, recommended antivirus best practices here. So now here, that's all. And now I want to give you, you know, lab access. So sir, I hope you have received a link, right? To log in into the Cisco portal to access the lab.
I received a link for the Cisco Learning Network space and for the Koenig Solutions student space.
Okay, sir. So, have you logged in with the username and password?
Yes. In which one do you mean? But I'm logged in both.
So let me. I think you need a token ID. So let me log in first. Then I will.